us love, hope, peace, joy, and life abundantly. We pray that today we come to hear and do the things that we can give our hearts, whether it's through some unsay or something completely different. We hear it as we give our hearts, and we ask us those gifts that you yourself promise to belong to us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's invite you open your Bibles to Isaiah chapter 9. And that is on page 722. There's a reference to Luke 22, I may refer to it when I preach the one of the New Testament fulfillment, but I'm mostly going to focus on Isaiah 9, 2-7. It's a context, a lot of it is in a piece that's in the Messiah, so we recognize this quite well. Read the word of the Lord. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living, the land of the shadow of death, a light has come. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you as people rejoice at the harvest, and men rejoice in the autumn thunder. For as in the day of Gideon, the deep you have shattered the yoke that burdens them and bar across their shoulders, the rod of the oppressors. Every warrior's food used in battle, and every garment rolled in blood, will be destined for burning, to be fuel for the fire. For unto us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. This is the word of the Lord. Last week, Sunday night, I participated and helped lead the ordination service of Reverend Helen Pontevelle at Southwest Community Church. It's a church that has already insisted that there will be, I guess it will be a parent church, or a church plant, and a church plant, and a bishop on church, and a parent church. And it's been a great one, getting to know Alan Pontevelle, and I gathered that opportunity to introduce him to you, but we will, and then you can hear more about that. But I'm really going to talk about the ordination service, not about the service itself, but what happened around the context of that. When I walked into the room down there on Godfrey, a man named Caleb came up to me and said, "Hey, Mark, hey, Mark." And Caleb was someone I'd known since I was just out of seminary. He was his brother, because his brother went to Turkey with us in program or department. But anyway, I got to know Caleb because he was his younger brother. And Caleb always had great questions that college students tend to ask. And I asked a lot of these questions too. Questions like, about the faith. You know, how can I be a Christian when I'm so busy? How can I be a devout follower of Jesus when I have so many passions, right, for life, for being a little bit wild, for other people, for gender, etc., etc., right? And how can I be serving God when I'm just so busy? And God kind of used me to speak into his life in about 5 or 10 minute segments throughout time. As I talked to him this time, he said, you always show up for transitions in my life. Whenever I'm transitioning, I never really do that. But at one point, when he was in college, I ended up having this conversation with him. And it was a little bit, I guess, weird in the sense of how much stuff was packed into that one moment. He was at the Calvary College Commons, so that's the area where you keep, I'm sure, like, these are all either go, right? And he was working there, and I talked to him, and we ended up getting to go from the third floor down to the first floor, and there's a funny elevator there. So we ended up in the elevator talking, and I knew it was a spiritual moment, so I actually kept pushing the door closed, right? And we talked for 3 minutes, it wasn't that long, but it got to be kind of funny because people were outside going, "Hey, where's the elevator? Open up!" But I was talking about God, and I really wanted to keep talking, and it was just a weird moment, about 3 minutes. And the question he asked at the time was, how do I have time for God? And how is stuff, how am I supposed to take God and learn about him? How can I even trust him? Ask him about the Bible. I said, look, here's the thing. People get the sense that he's supposed to be the Bible, an hour a day, and do devotions, and have a mountaintop experience with God and pretend to read it. Here's the thing. Just read 10 minutes a day, pick it up, put a timer on for 10 minutes, and then shut the Bible, and be done. That way you open yourself spiritual digestion, and it just works a lot better than thinking after every day. Read about 10 minutes a day, and it'll help, and then put it away. He said, when I just saw him last week, he said, no, I still remember that. He told me to be the Bible and see it and still do it, and it changed my life. And in fact, the transformation of him from a college kid who was pretty anxious about life to a father with three, a wonderful wife, there's a lot of peace in his life. He actually has peace, he has acceptance, he's comfortable with being around him, and he's really developed a strong relationship with Jesus Christ. When you look at this passage this morning, it's easy to think of the wonderful counselor of Prince of Peace. Think about Christmas and cookies and nice snowfall, sort of dead as a sound, and staying inside with family and hot chocolate and wonderful, amazing things. But actually, the passage of this passage talks about Jesus Christ being the Prince of Peace in very difficult, anxious, filled, horrible circumstances. If you look at this text, it says this. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. And those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has come. Do you think of situations in the world there with deep darkness? Where there's not hope, where there's difficulty. You don't think too far, right? That's South Sudan. War. The vice president and the president are supposed to work together instead of the other one of them. Whole countries pulled up. We know there's a huge Christian population there. Up to Syria, Giza, come on. There's right next door with a mother, there with a sister and brother down the street. Whole nation of Syria, middle class, a country, different faith, obviously. But because of the war, things got pulled up. And the whole country, just like us living here, the whole country is completely messed up, deep darkness. Situations without hope. You don't have to go too far and leave with California burning. Other countries around the world, think of Venezuela, Ukraine, Azerbaijan, Burma, or Myanmar. You know, there's so many places in the world that are experiencing incredible difficulty. Our country is not without difficulty either. There's something you're not supposed to do in a sermon, and I'm not teaching about a sermon, but there's something you're supposed to do in a sermon. It's still one of my favorite Zen props in a friend of mine. So, what you don't want to do in a sermon is you don't want to dig a hole deeper than you can fill. And you don't want to describe a situation in the world that's so horrible and so painful, and then throw an extra verse in it like John 3:16 and say, you know, it's all better, right? Because of all the hope, sensing something wasn't right for us. You don't want to describe a situation that the passage actually doesn't fill up. And I try to do that sometimes, you know. But today, this passage begs us to fill a big hole so deep, as deep as you can possibly imagine, because Jesus Christ came as a wonderful counselor, Prince of Peace, everlasting power, to fill the greatest hole, the greatest situation, the most difficult thing you can possibly imagine. And it's easy in our minds to think about peace and Christmas and joy, but actually, the passage invites us to think about the people who are walking in great darkness, who have no hope, who have no peace, who have no shalom. So let's think about a couple situations. And I'm doing this because it's going to foreshadow some of the stuff we're going to talk about in January. I'll tell you that. Think about World War II. My own parents, my own grandparents. This is World War II. That was the most simple agricultural people. At some point, Germany got a little aggressive and leave the country. And for my own father, nothing much changed. The administration just changed. But as the years went by, they saw more and more dysfunctional things. So the people, the Germans, the soldiers started rounding up Jews. And at first, they didn't really catch on to it, but they were segregated. And then they rounded them up. And then they loaded them on with trains. And eventually, they found out they got put in camps. And eventually, as the war continued, they found out that the people who were in charge were killing these people who were Jewish. And this sort of a gradual creep where the government started doing things they knew in the heart that government should not do so, many of them got involved in the resistance. There was a gradual thing where all of a sudden darkness dawns and there's something so dysfunctional going on. You think, how could this ever be? Think about slavery. I mentioned that I just read that book of Thomas Cabot, so that's not my mind. Imagine you were born and your skin was just happened to be a certain color, your ancestry was from a certain place, and you were born into a country because you have a certain color skin, you can be the property of other people. Maybe that worked really well because you had a great pastor who took care of you, but you knew that at every moment, any moment, he could sell you, or your wife, or your daughter, or your son, or your father, or your mother, and you would all be up to the auction block. Who would want to pay the highest bidder? This is not theory. This is actual people, brothers and sisters, who got sold. And in that context, this passage speaks. He is a wonderful concept. Here's the piece. It says he's come for people living in a great darkness. Not just a little bit of darkness, a great darkness. That's what this passage speaks about. Imagine maybe you're not a saint in that context. You're someone who wants to serve God with a sense of justice, and you're looking around, the government doing insane things, and the police doing crazy things that you know they should never do. And people, what am I supposed to do? Where is hope in this situation? Where is peace in this situation? And maybe you engage in the Underground Railroad, or maybe you engage in the courts, maybe, but really, what's the answer? What's the biblical answer? The biblical answer is that Jesus has come for exact situations like this. Not only in society, but also in our heart. So this really is a two-point sermon in many ways. It's about society, but it's also about the disorder and the darkness in our own heart. So in many ways, it's kind of a heavy sermon, so I thought I would do a little bit of an illustration here to write things up. This is an aquarium. It's not just any aquarium. This is an actual physical aquarium. Matt didn't have the greatest talent that he could pull here, right? And that's great. There's one toy Matt said, and that is fish. Now, when I set up an aquarium, I did some goldfish that a kid got from someone bizarre. We put the goldfish in it, and we sort of let it go, and eventually it really dirty because goldfish blew up. And we don't take care of it, my dog is fine. And it just ends up being another unmitigated, nasty disaster. And I just don't like, I don't know how to take care of fish. And Matt has a gift, utter amazing gift. And this is an aquarium he put together. You can come up here later and look at it. The bottom is beautiful, but his fish are amazing. And I guess someone just had babies last night. And there's a beta in here. Everybody knows to keep babies separate, the babies kill other fish. But it turns out if you know how to take care of them and feed them well, they don't put the beta around here somewhere. This is my picture of shalom. This is the point. This is my picture of perfect, amazing shalom. And it's really kind of subjective because it's all dependent on that. And it's a closed environment. They can't do much to create shalom, but there they are experiencing the shalom of Matt Holden's caretaking ability. That's how it works. Yeah, there's some analogies here where we're kind of in the same environment. We can't control our environment that well. It's subject to God's provision. So I don't want to mess with that aquarium, so we're going to come over here. Alrighty. So we have aquarium number two, and this one might not fit as well. So, alright, we've got some ornaments here. Got a nice passage of Isaiah 7, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign, behold the virgin shall conceive. Sorry, we've got some essence of gospel there. And we've got some fish. Now, I don't want to go fish, I got some Swedish fish. Turns out they don't flow so well, but it is what it is. You know, I'm limited illustration, but it's just a guess. So there they are. This is happening, and maybe not so happening. It's beautiful. But what happens in life, this is what happens in culture and society. Other things happen that aren't so pleasant. So maybe the first one is these friends are like that are in the office. This is a garbage bucket with a pirate's hat on. It's the most common garbage bucket I have, so put that in there. And stuff comes into our life sometimes, and we look at it, and we go, I'm not sure if I like that. I'm not sure if I like the garbage bucket. I can't see it right. Other times, people sort of go fishing for us. You get these phone calls, right? Hey, I literally had a phone call this week. And I called them back and said, oh, well, IRS, how can I help you? I'm like, nah, I'm not talking to you, right? So people go fishing for us, and they try to lure us into, whether it's on the phone or on a personal level, they seek to do us harm because of their own pain most often. And there's also a lot of companies. And sometimes people come directly after us. And this is the settlement of what settlement is. It's kind of ominous of the elevator is all the way out of there. And then there's, that's not great. Sometimes it's just trash in the world. We look around, and it's not so much directed against us, but people just don't care about the world so much, they take the styrofoam cups and throw it in our lives, and they're like, do you have to break out a styrofoam cup? Do you have to do that? And we're sort of like, really need this stuff in my life because of the way you want to live. And it's difficult. And to add on to this, sometimes the times are evil. I was listening to Tim Keller this week, and he was just, he couldn't really direct someone like he does. He said, well, the times are evil. Sometimes. We have this sort of narrative in Christianity in America where things are getting worse and worse and worse, and maybe are even more difficult, but biblically speaking, that simply isn't true, that now it's getting worse than it's ever been before. If you look at history, sometimes times are good people, and sometimes there's times of blessing. And that's a much more biblical, much more helpful category to understand. And the Bible sometimes is times of blessing, and sometimes literally it's times of evil. We might be going into a time that's a bit more evil. But there's a category for it, right? It's times of evil. And sometimes, for whatever reason, God allows things to be more mixed up, more evil than at other times. So we're just trying to deal with a certain extent, but sometimes things get messed up. And people get ground up. And you don't experience that so much personally, but very moderately. You know that there's countries that people get ground up and Christians are killed, and things are supposed to get horrible. And I thought about going over the top of an illustration, but this is actually pretty serious. But I do want to illustrate. Sometimes you put in society, and people don't care about God, it's like there's a big mixture that comes in our lives, and this sort of mixes everything up. We think, well, what are you doing, God? How come you're allowing this to happen? And more often than not, we don't get a direct answer, but we get an invitation to invite Jesus into your lives to be the Prince of Peace, wonderful counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father. And often when we do that, what we do is we experience the peace of God. And sometimes it's maybe like this little penguin in the aquarium. We experience the peace of God through the trauma of harm. Sometimes perhaps it might be a little bit like this one little fish that just moves us here, there, it keeps us out of harm's way time and time again. And sometimes it doesn't go too well. Sometimes it not feels good yet. Sometimes we lose them on our lives. Sometimes horrible things happen. We don't have an answer. We don't really have an answer exactly why that happened. Last year, at this time, we lost my mom and my sister. And it was so strange, because we went into their hospital room the first time we visited, and they literally were in the same hospital room, looking very much the same spot. And you think, how God, what is it? It couldn't be none of this. There was some providential things happening where they're both in the bed. Together. Last night I walked into the fellowship hall here, and I shared before I was in college that a girlfriend who was killed in a car accident, and it took about 5 or 6 years for me to even heal from that. And being able to see the difference, I felt my wife and my kids was amazing. But her sister was with us, like her sister married, sister was here last night, and I walked through the fellowship hall and Bonnie's like, hey, how are you doing? I'm like, just trying to keep my composure together. I thought, all that stuff, back. And we don't live in a perfect world. You live in a really difficult world that's also incredibly beautiful. But we live in a context that's just full of difficulty and full of pain and full of awful things happening all the time. But the passage invites us to consider the two realities and put them on the same page. So we don't just go, that's good, that's good, it's so good, I have so many things in my life, and also you experience badly, and you're like, oh, my goodness, I'm not sure if that was good, I'm not sure I like this. He invites us to put it on the same page, where what's good, and he loves me, and he cares for me, and what's really good, and also when it's really insanely difficult, and why is the Prince of Peace, he's involved in both things at the same time. As in the day of Gideon's defeat, the shadow yoke that burns and the bar across the shoulders, the rod of the oppressor. It's interesting that people are always thinking of it, not people that often experience oppression personally. Lack of peace is often directly related to oppression. It's directly related to people most of them in other ways. Taking advantage of other people for their own benefit and not caring about human life, about human rights. Because people who, for some reason, have shut off some part of their brain, they don't care about other people, even the extent that those other people are going to be around, and those systems get themselves perpetrated or created. That's often what happens to these kids, is oppression. And what God says And he just comes shattering all of your life. And you hear him we're going to do a series on immigration. And we look at that biblically. And then Sam would look at the man, they both obey the law, but also care for the alien, the foreigner, and the widow within their gates. Is that what God's heart is? We haven't, most of us haven't experienced war. We haven't experienced government that have been rolling and rolling. Lawyers and police, so people only there because they were tough and uncomfortable in the war and afterwards they were looking. But it says here that all that stuff's going to be burned. If you feel the fire and remember no more. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow is a poet that you probably know the name of it. But he's also a Christian. And about the power of Jesus Christ. And one horrible day in his life, his wife's dress caught fire, and she got totally burned and eventually died. A few years later, he was enlisted in the Civil War, his son went out to war, to join the war, after he became a captain, and I think he lived that got injured. And he had watched the one that was walking around Christmas season, and the snow was beautiful, but obviously his country at war, his wife's gone, his son's at war. And you hear the bells on Christmas Day, he's like, you know what, peace on earth. I'm not seeing it. And you know the song that is about, I heard the bells on Christmas Day. It says, the old familiar carols play, and wild and sweet the words would be, but peace on earth and good will to men. He says, and in despair I bow my head, there's no peace on earth, I said. And he gets strong and mocks the song, but peace on earth and good will to men. Very legitimate prayer. We have this thought for life, personal, or corporate, or national. These are very legitimate thoughts to bring to God. And then Jesus invites you to bring your pain to God. You can take it. You can take it. It's honesty with God. Honesty with God goes a long way. But when he listens again, he says, then peel the bells more loud than he can tell again, but in his heart, perhaps, God is not dead, but left in sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right will fail, and peace on earth will go to man. And in this situation, the last 67 or 100 years, God in time, in his time, comes around and changes the whole thing. We see that with events in the past, in the Civil War, the slavery in America. And that's often, biblically speaking, times of people last about 60 to 70 or 80 years. And then come back around again. So we're much more helpful than we hope to be able to grow. Things aren't getting worse and worse. The seasons are good. The seasons are difficult. The new thought last week was, in order to love God, you have to love yourself. In order to love yourself, you have to love God. And what I thought of this week is that I think you have to do both of those things, and faith and hope are wrapped up in those things. I think you have to do both of those things, love yourself, love God, love God, love yourself, in order to truly experience peace in this world. If you don't love who you are, as this man loves to think about, if you don't love God, if you don't know his love for you, if you don't know who he is and who you are, in different situations, whether it's burning fires in California, or whether it's a difficulty in your life, or a cancer diagnosis, or a migraine headache, or war in far off places, or difficulty in America, policies, you want to have peace. When you love God and love yourself, when you know who loves you and you love God, when you know God and he knows you, and all of a sudden, you get to these new situations and experience peace because you know before you get to it that God is a God of peace. And he's also a God that wants to bring peace to people living in very areas. It's what he does. It's the message of Christmas. And I love how we have this great tradition in prayer. We give each other gifts, we bake too many candies, we get together with people, and I just say, like this last night, you are so blessed with so many good things and that you can do with your pocket. I never got to do that as I did. And I think it's beautiful. But God didn't just come so we can do those things. God came for people who were living in most of those situations. A couple weeks ago, a lady named Ariana and I came to church here. She was walking outside for a couple hours with her 8-month-old girl. And she had been kicked out of her house because she didn't have papers for the state. And people who she was living with this declined to call up and they wanted to be arrested by immigration services. And so she didn't walk around the crowded hour and some ladies here about her. For a couple of hours, she had a phone call from different places. And it gets to some parents from Nancy came about. When I think about Christmas and Easter, I think about people like Anna, whose parents have been deported to Ecuador because they were refugees who were developed, and she can't have a child because there's no permission to be transferred. When I think about these three pieces, I think about a family I talked to this week who had to kick the father of her child out of the house because he's abusive to her. And I feel so glad she did it. Otherwise, it's a lifetime of dysfunction. It's not something that applies to. And these are super good life. And I could share a dozen more stories in the last couple of weeks and still with you. And you're living your life. This is what you need to do. This is what the game is. Let me share one last story. And it's this. We kind of point you here. So, the point of marriage counseling this week, this was rather fun. We have marriage counseling through premarital counseling, actually. And I think premarital counseling is really important that both people, if they're all willing to, love Jesus, right? Because it's important for these trans, obviously, these faiths, come up with God and each other. So it's really important to do your Christian wedding that people actually submit themselves to you. So this is what they're going to recommend. Are you committed to Jesus Christ? And this is the way I talk about it. There's a couple different ways to view Jesus. And one is up here, where it's just not, you just don't believe. That's all there is to it. You don't believe, so like, I'm not going to go there. I'm not really appreciative about any case of gossip or maybe something else. I just don't believe. That's perspective. And this tie, I'm a bad list of this, by the way. It's amazing. It's amazing. Now, if you want something drawn while talking to kids, so like, this is what I do when I talk to people, I just go, this is an eye, so you see Jesus. No, I believe, I see that other people believe, I know about the Bible, I think it's all right, it's okay for other people to believe, but honestly, I just look at it from the outside. And I don't really endorse it, I don't really follow it. And you know, like Larry was talking about, people like this, they see it, they don't realize it before, but honestly, we're just looking at it from the outside. It's a perspective, and it's very absent, this one perspective, this idea. This is my awesome drawing on my wallet, right? Because I always put too much stuff on my wall. It falls up on my bed. It doesn't look pretty good. And then I messed up another time, but I made it look first. And this is an analogy. I'm not going to tease out everything in this analogy, but this is a great analogy because some of us have Jesus in our wallet. And it's not that we don't believe, it's not that we don't trust, but it's like something we pull out every once in a while, like, okay, where is that card? Okay, there it is. I got it. And it's not, we don't devalue it, but we don't really pay attention to it all the time. We just pull it out once in a while, like, hey, here it is. And then we also discard it once in a while, like, oh, well, I don't know where it is. We either lose it, or we just don't care about it because we're doing something else. Jesus doesn't want to be in our wallet to be pulled out as a resource to use from time to time. Jesus wants to be in our heart, in my awesome drawing of a heart. That's where he wants to live. In the center of who we are, our swamp mind, the Greek word is in our intestines, in our gut. He wants to be the center of our heart. And when we invite Jesus into the center of our heart, that's when we can experience peace. When we do the work of spending time and asking, do I know God? Does he know me? Do I love God? Does God love me? That's when we experience peace, no matter what comes. And so, I was talking to Don this week in the hospital. And one of the things he said is, I have peace. I have peace. And it hadn't occurred to me that she might not have peace because I really respect her as a woman of God. But she processed this and thought, do I have peace? And the answer is yes. Absolutely yes. Because she's invited God and invested the heart. And that's the invitation. And here is the application. Are there areas of your life where you find you may not be the most peaceful person ever, right? So what's your trigger point? What do you need to do? Is it with sovereign? Is it with family? Is it at work? When you get a boss or an employee who drives you absolutely crazy? Is it when you watch the news and you get upset and like, oh, no. Is it when you see a certain person on TV and you think, oh, I hate this? Is it when you watch a certain kind of movie? And then when you go shopping and come home with way too much stuff in your credit card, like, where is the point in life where you think, I don't have much peace? And then I want to invite you to invite God into that moment and help them talk to me. I want them to talk to me. I want them to give you peace, give you assurance that this world is for you. Because it could be at some point that God isn't really at the center of your heart at that moment. Anger, frustration, or rage, or any place that there's someone to be on. I said in the end, there was like some young people here who are just being inspired in life. We are invited Jesus Christ peace into our lives so that we can be effective in the world around us and bring peace to bear in every kind of situation. So, for my father and my father, especially when young, they look at the situation and don't resistance. He said, I need peace somehow in this context to help people escape and kill. About a century ago, people were involved in the Ottoman era here. They looked at it and they said, I need to help people escape slavery, escape oppression. This is why I'm called to do it. Other people fought politically. People didn't look at their call to do it. In your life, some of you care more than some of you care, some of you care. But what we're invited to do is get filled with the power of God so we can be peaceful in different situations. And that is messing with Christmas. Let me pray. Father God, I thank you for who you are. I thank you for your wisdom, for your grace, for your power, for the strength in our lives. And I pray, first of all, that you would bring peace in each one of our situations. And I just pray that you help your Father. And I invite you that here in my life, I don't have peace, but I have frustration, anger, and being rage from time to time. I invite you that here in my life, I have anxiety and fear. And even sometimes I control that fear and go, what the hell? But I invite you that here in my life, I have this lust. It's lust for stuff, or lust for people. I invite you in that area of my life, and invite you in that area of my life, speak to me in peace. Now I pray that by your Spirit, by your fruit, and God, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, and you help to be a person who created to be. And by your gifts, whether it's mercy, or giving, or helping, or more prophetic gifts of prayer and knowledge and intercession, I pray that you could be the force of power, the force of mercy, the force of strength, be the person that you created to be in this world. That you would do amazing and wonderful things and we can ask for God to improve me, through each one of us. And be the purpose of the church, share this in the future, to take the message of Jesus all around the world with power. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.